Hi, I'm Miguel Ordeñana. I'm a wildlife biologist and community science manager here at the Natural History Museum of Los Angeles County. And I'm going to be talking to you all about bats. I'm going to be talking about the myths, the misconceptions we have about them, and also what structures they rely on to survive here in Los Angeles, so we can better learn how to coexist with them and protect them for future generations. Imagine a bat. Huge diversity of bats in the world. And a lot of you, I bet, thought of an image like this. Flying foxes are probably the most popular bats because how big they are can be intimidating to some, and for others, they're really cute and make people fall in love with bats. But they serve a very important role in the ecosystem as fruit eaters. And so what they do is poop out the seeds, which helps regenerate trees and forests and plantations in some cases. Something interesting is that these bats are more willing to fly over deforested habitat than birds. And so when you think about a clear-cut forest and what species are going to be bringing those forests back to life, it's more likely going to be these bats than birds. And so flying foxes, like a lot of other species, have an important role that just isn't talked about enough. And we think about the myths, the legends, the misconceptions, and don't think about how important they are to our economy and to our health even. But it's Halloween, and so I gotta bring up Dracula and the myths behind Dracula and how that's connected to the vampire bat, which has a pretty bad reputation thanks to the Dracula legend and the vampire's reputation. And what's the connection between Dracula and bats? Well, this species of bat, the vampire bat, is a bat that drinks the blood of mammals or birds. There's three species in the world, and only one of them drinks mammal blood. They were given the name vampire by European explorers that visited Central America, where these animals are native to, and gave them that name, and would write notes home about what they saw and how they were observed drinking blood and really exaggerating a lot of their natural history, so that this legend kind of built up and built up. And in the late 1800s, which is when Bram Stoker wrote Dracula, there was a lot of disease prevalence in Europe and people dying from syphilis and cholera and horrible diseases like that. And so bats and this legend were kind of capitalize on all this death and these sickly individuals and the fear brought about by bats and our lack of understanding of medicine and how to cure diseases. And so really Dracula is basically building on people's fears, and the vampire bat was unfortunately the victim of that. And so there's a lot of hatred against the vampire bat, but the truth of the matter is these bats are out mostly going after nocturnal mammals. They're out in the forest at night and drinking their blood and usually really having no impact on them. And they make a little incision with sharp teeth, and they have this anticoagulant in their saliva that they drop into the wound and allows the blood in that wound to come out so they can lap up that blood like a dog or a cat drinks milk. And then the other group of bats that are out there are the pollinating bats. So the nectar-feeding bats, like this one is the Mexican long-nosed bat. This bat uses its long tongue to drink nectar from flowers, and they're largely responsible for pollinating nocturnal flowering plants, which includes agave and a lot of cactus species that are nocturnally flowering plants. They rub up, as they're doing this and drinking that nectar, they're rubbing against the flower and gathering all that pollen on their fur. And then once they visit another flower, they transfer that pollen to the other plant, just like a bee would during the day. There's over 1,400 species of bat, which makes them over 20% of all mammal species in the world. And they're usually long-lived for their size. So you usually think about a small animal like a bat, especially like the bumblebee bat, which is super tiny. You think, oh, they probably only live a year or a couple years at most, just like a squirrel or a rat would. They have a lot of babies, but they all die pretty quickly. But that's just not the case for bats. They actually have the ability to live a very long time, and some bats can live up to 40 years. They save the agriculture industry billions of dollars annually by acting as natural pest control. They go around eating crop pests that would otherwise create a lot of damage on our local crops and force our farmers to lose a lot of money and also have to invest in pesticide, which is bad for the environment, but also very costly. Instead of investing in pesticide, they're saving that money which makes our groceries at the grocery store, especially our produce, cheaper thanks to these bats. And so the majority of all bats eat insects. A lot of people think that most bats eat drink blood or they mostly eat fruit. But most bats in the world, no matter where you are eating insects. And all LA County bats only eat insects. They are not blind for the most part. Most bats can see just as well as we can and can echolocate, which means that they can use sonar, sending out this ultrasonic sound, which is sound that's so high pitched that we can't hear it, but provides this animal with an echo after it bounces off an object. It bounces back to them and to their ears, and they can create a mental image of what's in front of them. And so they use this ability to find food at night and to communicate, navigate, and hunt in darkness. And to this point, some insects actually are evolving to drop out of the sky or send out their own sound to confuse and jam these signals of the bats so that they aren't killed by the bats and hunted by the bats. But it's an ongoing battle. Research in LA County has been dominated by research in natural open spaces where a lot of people would expect to find bats. So if you look at this information, you'd assume that, oh, bats aren't using the city. They're not using the urban core. And because all these research projects are going to these natural open spaces like the Angeles Forest or Santa Monica Mountains to do their work and just ignoring potential populations that are living in the urban core of Los Angeles. And so I felt that there was a need there. And our NHM bat collection is also shedding a lot of light on what's been here in LA and what persists here in LA. And we have a huge collection of bats all over the world. It's probably one of the strongest parts of our mammal collection here at the Naturalist Museum. Over 2,500 specimens in California, over 400 specimens from LA County alone, and 17 species from LA County. 19 species have been documented as living here in LA County. And our collection has identified 17. And so some evidence I've had of that, how bats can be resilient, is that I put an acoustic detector, which I use to study bats using their species-specific calls. So I use this microphone to pick up their echolocations, and each bat has a unique pattern to their call, a unique pitch. And so I'm able to study bats just by collecting their sound. And so I did this at the LA Zoo because it was a protected area. It was an urban, in the middle of the city, but still in this kind of isolated wildlife oasis. And so I put the bat detector out there and had success. Griffith Park is over 4,000 acres, but still an isolated patch of habitat, and was able to document a bat that was thought to be gone from LA for over a decade. And it was the Western Mastiff bat, which is the biggest bat in North America, has a wingspan of almost 2 feet, and is reliant on long bodies of water because it has to glide over water to be able to drink and eat. And so it's limited to certain types of habitats. So the LA River, for instance, might be very important for this animal to be able to survive in this city, or big reservoirs or lakes like Echo Park Lake, MacArthur Park Lake, etc. And then I joined the museum and I immediately put a bat detector out there because it's an even smaller open space, only 3.5 acres compared to the 4,000 acres that Griffith Park has to offer. And in this space, I've detected over 5 species, including species that are of special concern in the state of California, which are species that are sensitive to urbanization. And if urbanization continues to go at the pace that it's going, these particular species of concern will go extinct from California. And so one of those bats was the Western Red Bat, and it visited the gardens multiple times, which really shows that you don't have to have a Santa Monica Mountains range or Angeles National Forest to be able to have bats living in the region. You actually just need to have some patches of habitat that give them a little bit of a break during the day, and if they're migratory, allow them breaks to be able to move around. And some bats, like the Western Red Bat, only roost in foliage. So they don't like roosting in bridges or other structures, only roost in trees. For our gardens to have the trees that it has, and those trees are now establishing and very big with huge canopies, are really important to bats. And it shows, even if you build a little garden, even if it's like a community garden, that can go a long way for sensitive bats like that. And here's what these echolocations look like. So for the Mexican free-tailed bat, which is the most common bat in LA, these flatter oscillations versus the Myotis species have more hockey stick shaped calls. I did some work in the LA River to confirm what bats are more restricted to river habitat in the middle of the city to show that bats are not just using these big, large open spaces. The most common bat, like I said, is the Mexican free-tailed bat. What's really interesting about this bat is that it's the fastest flying animal in the air. And a lot of people think peregrine falcons are that animal, but if you think about a bat flying in a straight direction, not doing a deep dive, they can fly 100 miles an hour. The Myotis species was also detected quite a bit along the LA River, and there was a lot of research that shows that this species is attracted to and reliant upon riparian habitat or habitat that exists along rivers. It's great to confirm that, and that the LA River serves that role, even though it's a lot of it's channelized in concrete, still supporting this river specialist, the California Myotis. But to get even deeper into urban core, we have to involve community members and engage the community in community science, which are projects in which volunteers partner with scientists to answer real-world questions. And what this allows us to do is it gives us access to previously inaccessible habitat, more specifically private property and backyards. It gives us information that we never had before. And in a place like Los Angeles that's over 70% urban private property, it's really important to fill in these gaps, because if you totally study everything but the urban core, you're missing 70% of our study area, of our ecosystem here in LA. It also allows you to increase the scale. When you get the community involved and with the help of technology, you can really get a sense of what's out there with the community's help. And it's not relying upon the people power of just a few scientists to do that work. Started putting up some bat detectors in yards for about a month at a time to see what I got, and covered about 9 locations in that very first year. But of those 19 species that all these projects have discovered over the years in these natural open spaces, in backyards alone that very first year, I was able to detect 12 of the 19 species, which is pretty remarkable. 4 of those species were species special concern, and they're all adorable. They all look like little cotton balls with wings. The most dominant species in our study in their backyards were Mexican free-tailed bats, of course, and we discovered the pocketed free-tailed bat that we thought only lived in up to Orange County, but now we know lives in LA County in a few different spots. And the silver-haired bat was thought to be mostly in Northern California and the Bay Area, and in forested habitat, is also detected multiple times in Los Angeles. And the Western yellow bat, a species of special concern, also a foliage roosting specialist like the red bat, that not only is a foliage specialist, but only roosts primarily in palm trees, which, as we know, are iconic here in LA. Is relying upon those trees for it to be able to persist here. But we're discovering it everywhere. And also, you're able to get a hoary bat, very similar to a red bat, also a foliage specialist, a migratory bat that migrates from southern Canada all the way down to Latin America every year and back, and needs those resting spots along the way. And it's proving that LA, our nature gardens, is one of those spots, because this picture is of a hoary bat in our nature gardens, clinging to the side of our museum, which is pretty cool to see that we can offer that opportunity for this bat. We're also learning some unfortunate trends in the other direction, where we're seeing the big brown bat, which was thought of to be this really urban adapted bat and considered a pest in some parts of the country, getting attics dirty and smelly with their poop. But here in LA, they're very, very hard to find, it seems like. We've discovered 20 sites and only have detected them in a handful of these sites, which is pretty alarming. And we're not sure quite what's going on, but we think that they're pretty sensitive to urban development. And a lot of the roosting habitat that they use is a lot of times the habitat that is first to be demolished, like industrial warehouses and things like that. And so something to think about as we think about how we can better do some urban planning with bat conservation in mind. Then I expanded the work with the support of the Disney Conservation Fund and involved the community members and was able to get funding for 20 bat detectors, these acoustic detectors, and put them out in different backyards all over the city, from suburban neighborhoods to really industrial neighborhoods throughout the city. And again, of those 12 species of bats that we detected that first year, we were able to detect a good chunk of those, about 9 species. As we expanded the study, we not only included more yards, but we also included local parks that have these large lakes or reservoirs where you'd expect to have more activity because these bats are highly associated with lakes and water because they eat insects, and a lot of insects breed in the water and are active near water. And so we put bat detectors in parks just a few blocks away from some of these backyards that we were monitoring. The results were remarkable. We got over 10 times the activity in these parks compared to these nearby backyards, showing how some of these bats are really relying upon some of these big urban parks to survive and probably have roosting habitat, not only feeding habitat as well. We're expanding that work by involving the community to figure out exactly where they're going during the day and hiding out during the day, because it was a common question by the community. They wanted to know not only what neighborhoods they were flying over, but actually where they were calling home during the day, so that we can know what artificial roosts to protect in addition to what natural roosts to protect. There's this disease called white nose syndrome that's devastating to bat populations all over the country, especially cave-dwelling bats. But we don't know how that might affect bats if this disease does reach Southern California, because we don't know if our bats are hibernating, and hibernating bats that live in caves are the most vulnerable because this disease keeps them active during the day. It's a fungus that enters their nasal passage and keeps them active during times where they need to be resting and conserving energy. And so we don't know how that would affect bats that potentially really aren't hibernating. And without knowing where they're roosting and what type of structures they're roosting in, we were not going to be able to plan ahead to protect them if the white nose syndrome does reach Los Angeles and the Southern California area. So we've gotten involved in this national count involving families, Boys and Girls Clubs, libraries, and also schools like Jordan High School and Watts. We're asking these different communities to collect data, but also what we're doing is they're part of those discoveries. We're not just parachuting in, getting data, and leaving. Regardless of your background, where you live, you have the opportunity to make a huge impact and a huge discovery and contribution to wildlife research here in LA. And so I encourage you to participate. We specifically really want to know if you see bats flying out of some sort of structure, whether it's a tree or someone's garage. We want to know that information so we can start to map where these bats are living. A personal encounter I had with bats. I went to USC. I'm a big football fan, and I try to go to games when I can. And my brother was aware that I study bats, and he said, "Miguel, there's bats eating moths around the stadium lights because moths are attracted to lights." It's like, oh, really? And because I'm a bat nerd, of course, I have had a bat acoustic detector in my pocket. And I ended up standing up in the middle of a game and probably upset some people behind me, and stood up and listened for bats. But even though I seem like a weirdo in this situation, I feel like as technology gets cheaper, easier to use, and more accessible, and as more people learn that bats share LA with us, I think one day there'll be a stadium full of people with bat detectors. And at halftime, everybody will be standing up looking for bats, because at that point, they'll know bats are here, they'll understand their value, and they'll just be hungry for more information. Thank you for joining us for this presentation, and thank you for your membership, for supporting the Natural History Museum of LA County and projects like ours. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on social media at NHMLA.